Okay, today we are reading Court Square, written by Tracy Ann Canada. Cheddarman, take it away.
Court Square, written by Tracy Ann Canada. Based on a little-told true story. Exterior, Montgomery Ward Department Store, day. Four-year-old child, Claudette Colvin, a dark-skinned girl with kinky hair pulled into two ponytails, holds her mother, Mary Colvin's hand as they cross the street. In Mary's arm is another young girl, Delphine, dark-skinned and around 2 years old. Mary is a dark-skinned woman in her 50s. The streets are busy with a mixture of blacks and whites, but the two groups are careful not to interact with each other. Claudette, Mary, and Delphine enter through a side door marked Colored's Entrance, Super 1943. Inside Montgomery Ward Department Store, Mary looks through racks of clothes and Claudette wanders away to explore. The racks of clothes tower over her, placing her in a clothes-infested jungle. Claudette darts in and out of the racks. The sound of laughter echoes around her, and she turns to see three white boys, maybe a few years older. The boys are laughing and pointing at her. She stomps over to the boys.
Why is you guys laughing?
Your skin is funny.
Yeah, let us see your hand.
Claudette clutches her hand to her chest.
Why?
Because your skin is different.
She cautiously reaches out her hand. One of the boys touches her hand, comparing the differences.
Claudette!
Claudette looks up to see her mother looking around for her. Mary sees Claudette and rushes over. She puts Delphine down on the floor and grabs Claudette.
What do you think you're doing?
Mary looks around and sees a white woman watching them. She reaches back and backhands Claudette.
Don't you know better than to touch white folks?
The white woman nods in approval.
It wasn't my idea.
It doesn't matter. Never touch white folks.
Claudette nods, but her face is scrunched in a look of anger and fights back tears. In a car outside of the hospital, St. June's Hospital looms in the background. In the car sits a 13-year-old Claudette alone. Her hands are clutched together and her face raised up to the roof. Tear tracks streak her face.
Dear Lord, I try not to ask for too many things, but today is my birthday and I really need a big present. My sister, she's sick. I can't live without her. I don't need anything else for my birthday and I will never ask for anything again. Just please deliver her from this.
Continued, the car's front doors opens, and QP and Mary get in. They are silent as QP starts the car.
Next time we come, can I please visit Delphine? I'll be good. I won't be too loud, and I will only whisper.
Mary turns around in her seat.
Oh, Claudette.
At a graveyard, it is raining. Claudette clings to her mother under a shared umbrella. QP stands up next to them. There are several people gathered around a grave. Apart from the crowd is a pastor.
Sometimes God calls us back home earlier than expected, but we're not on our own schedule, we're on His. There are times that are hard, but we must remember God has a plan, and His will is absolute. Our little Delphine had polio, and the Lord saw fit to take her home. We can only thank Him for taking her pain away.
We see a gravestone. Delphine Austin, birth 1941, death 1952. Inside the Colvin home front room, Claudette is curled up in a corner of the couch. She has a book in her hand, but is staring off into space. She doesn't notice as Mary comes into the room and looks at Claudette with concern. Mary sits next to Claudette, who still notices nothing. Mary places a hand on Claudette's leg, causing her to jump in surprise.
You okay, baby?
Claudette starts to nod, but tears stream down her face. Mary gathers her into a hug.
What's wrong?
Why didn't God answer my prayers? Did I do something wrong? Did He just hate us Negroes?
No, of course not. Tell me, what did you pray for?
I prayed for her deliverance.
And you think God didn't do that? I prayed that God would deliver her too. I prayed that he would welcome her into the eternal home. I prayed that she wouldn't have to live paralyzed for the rest of her life. So, to me, he did answer our prayers.
Claudette slams her book closed.
I would have taken care of her if she was paralyzed. I would have gone to school and become a nurse and dedicated my life to taking care of her.
I know you would have, but that would have ruined both your lives. And now you're both free.
What's the point of being free if God can just take whatever he wants? From now on, I'm not going to let anything stop me from taking what I want.
Mary gasps.
Claudette, God does what is best for us.
Taking Delphine was not what is best for us.
It is okay to be angry at God, but he puts nothing in our path that we cannot handle. Take this anger and turn it towards something you can help change, because no matter how furious you get, you can't bring your sister back.
Obviously, he isn't going to do anything to help me get what I want, so I am going to have to do things myself.
At a church, Super 1955, there's an old wooden church with people dressed in their Sunday's best filing in. One family is Claudette and her parents, Mary and QP. The sound of gospel singing spills out to the church. Claudette has grown into a pretty, bespectacled 15-year-old, carrying a little black Bible. Her hair is straightened, pinned up, and curled at the edges. Mary has sprouted a few gray hairs over the years, and her husband looks equally old. Inside the church sanctuary, the preacher, Reverend H.H. Johnson, stands at the altar giving a fiery sermon. Many members of the congregation are standing and clapping. There is one old lady with the beginnings of the Holy Ghost running through her, and many more yelling praises and shouting, Hallelujah!
The Bible says in John 5:24 that Jesus saves all that worship him. Now see, Jesus was sent down from being at home with his Father, God, so he could die for our sins.
More shouts of praise echo around the small sanctuary.
Not just certain people, like some folks would have you believe, but all the people. Can I get an amen?
Amen!
Amen.
He died for the Jews and the Gentiles. He died for all the people that are willing to get on their knees and praise him.
Amens echo around the room.
We have to remember that no matter what happens out there in the secular world, Jesus loved us enough to sacrifice his life for ours. We are worth that much to him.
Claudette stands up to applaud the preacher. She stomps her feet and yells her amens. Later in the church sanctuary, Claudette stands in line to greet the preacher. Each person before her moves up to shake the reverend's hand and thank him for the sermon.
Reverend Johnson, that was a particularly powerful sermon this morning.
Why, thank you, Miss Claudette. I'm glad to hear you enjoyed it.
Oh, yes, sir. It is always a nice reminder that we are worthy of Jesus' love. Sometimes it is hard to remember. I remember there was a time I was so mad at God.
Yes, I know. The world beats us down. But I need you to always remember that you can stand back up by the grace of God. He loves each of us and will never put anything in our path we can't handle.
Yes, sir. That's what my mama says, too.
Smart young women should always listen to their mamas. Now, I believe you have a youth council meeting downstairs you should be getting to.
In the church basement, the walls are covered in posters of civil rights slogans, Bible verses, and a picture of white Jesus. Claudette is still wearing her church clothes and is the lone one standing at a table of teenagers. They are all staring in rapt attention at Claudette, more to be entertained than in agreement with anything she is saying.
Ain't no black man gonna rape no stupid white woman. Jeremiah Reeves is innocent.
A middle-aged, light-skinned woman, Rosa Parks, steps forward from where she was watching in the corner.
Now, Claudette.
Nuh-uh, he ain't raper. He says they agreed to sex. Why would he risk his life raping her?
I think it is time we move.
She got more reason to lie about this than he would for raping her.
Please, can we?
He was our neighbor. He was our friend. Half of you had crushes on him and would go see the shows he drummed in. But now that he needs us, you are all gone?
Rosa is visibly tired of Claudette talking over her.
Claudette, this is not the time nor place for this discussion.
Claudette's naturally defiant face turns to Rosa.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Parks, but if not now, when? If not here, where? The Youth Council is supposed to be about the injustices in the Negro community.
Yes, it is, and today's meeting was supposed to be about ideas for our fundraiser for new school books. You have been given ample time to talk about Mr. Reeves in multiple meetings.
Several of the teens around the table stifle laughter.
Other chapters of the NAACP are working for Mr. Reeves' defense, but here we will consider the topic closed.
In the church basement office, Rosa sits behind a desk covered in neatly stacked piles of paper. She is writing on something while Claudette sits impatiently waiting. Rosa puts down her pen, sighs, and looks up at Claudette.
I commend your passion for civil rights, Claudette, but you have to realize that you can't go shouting about it all the time.
I shout because when I talk, no one listens.
Things take time. You have to be patient. One day your mouth is going to get you in trouble.
I don't care about getting in trouble as long as people hear me.
You aren't going to want people to hear you when you holler in the wrong thing. Child, I just want you to be safe. The police, the Klan, white folks in general aren't ready to hear a young black girl yelling about injustice. Leave it to the grown-ups.
So I'm old enough to have to worry about getting hurt, but not old enough to say the things that might get me hurt.
You know that's not what I mean. No matter your age, you need to watch what you say. In our meetings, you are safe. But if you go around saying the wrong thing around the wrong person, you will end up in jail or worse, hanging from a tree somewhere.
But Mrs. Parks...
No buts. You need to be more careful. Promise me.
Mrs. Parks...
No, Claudette. Promise me you will be safe and try to keep yourself out of trouble.
Claudette looks torn between the need to speak her mind and the need to please Rosa.
Yes, ma'am. I'll do my best.
Outside on the sidewalk, Claudette stands with a couple of her friends. They all have their school books in their hands. A bus pulls up to the corner. One by one, the girls get on the bus, then right back off until it is Claudette's turn. She walks onto the bus. There are several white patrons on the bus, and in the back are many more blacks. Claudette pays her fare, then gets off the bus to make way for the next girl. She heads to the back door, just as all the other girls did, and climbs on through there. She finds a seat a few rows into the black section where a couple of her schoolmates already are. Inside the bus, Claudette sits on the bus watching the scenery go by. The bus stops to let on a few more white patrons. She looks up to watch as more people get on the bus. There are white riders in every row, but not all of the seats are full. Still, the two new riders walk to the first row of the black section and stand waiting. The bus driver sees that they are standing there.
Hey, you coloreds, they need seats. Get up.
The row of black passengers get up and move farther back into the crowded black section. The white women sit and chat as if nothing out of the ordinary has happened, because it is not strange. Outside the Colvin home, the house is a small one, a ranch on the top of a hilly neighborhood with old white paint. The fence is worn, so is the porch. There is a horse on the side of the house. Despite all of the shabbiness, the house is obviously loved and well taken care of. Inside the home, in the dining room, Mary is at the stove stirring a pot, and her husband, QP, sits in a rocking chair reading the evening paper. Claudette sets the table, talking to her parents so fast they can barely keep up.
And then today, for our extended Negro History Week, we talked about Harriet Tubman.
What about her?
How she freed a bunch of slaves, and even when she gained her own freedom, she just kept on going back down south to get more slaves. She didn't want to be the only free one.
That's mighty impressive of her.
Yeah, not only that, but she was a spy for the Union Army and led a raid that freed more than 700 slaves.
A woman did all that?
Uh-huh. When I grow up, I'm going to be just like her, freeing my people.
I'm sure you will. With your mouth, you could easily be a lawyer. Forever talking a mile a minute.
You're right. I can be a lawyer. That's what I'll be, and I'll work for the NAACP to help more make sure more people ain't arrested for stuff they ain't do.
You know what? I'm sure you will do it. You was so dang smart and can do anything you put your mind to.
Claudette nods decisively.
I'm going to be a lawyer for the NAACP. Then I'm going to be the first black lady president.
Mary stops stirring and considers her for a second.
From anyone else, I would think they talking crazy. But I believe you. You're going to be a lawyer fighting for Negroes' rights. Then going to be a president.
Outside City Hall, people walk in and out of the building. All of the people are white except one lone black woman. This is Joanne Robinson, a light-skinned African-American woman. She walks up the stairs and into the building as though she has every right to be there. She is impeccably dressed with a stylish skirt suit on and a starched white shirt. Her heels clack against the sidewalk with every step. Several white people look at her, but no one stops her. Inside, in the mayor's office, a heavy-set white man, W.A. Gale, sits behind the desk in a nicely furnished office. It isn't too opulent, but befits his position as mayor of Montgomery. His secretary, a white woman, pokes her head in.
Sir, there is a, Negro woman here to see you.
A Negro woman? Who is she?
She says her name is Joanne Robinson. Says she's a member of that Women's Political Council. She wants to talk to you about the city buses.
The Women's Political Council? Damn it. Send her in.
The secretary pulls her head out of the way.
He says you may go in.
A moment later, Joanne walks into the room.
Thank you for seeing me, Mr. Mayor.
Gale smiles a fake smile.
How could I turn down a member of the Honorable Women's Political Council?
The look on his face shows how much he wishes he could have turned down the meeting. Joanne laughs at his discomfort. It isn't a cruel laugh, but more of a soft amusement.
I know there are a lot of people who wish we weren't as influential as we were. Who wants Negro women with any power?
Gale clears his throat, clearly uncomfortable with the way the conversation is going.
Well, what brings you to my office today, Miss Robinson?
Montgomery buses, sir.
Joanne pulls out a slip of paper from her purse.
We, of the Women's Political Council, ask for the following three changes to the bus rules.
Gale's face morphs into surprise at her audacity, but he says nothing.
1. We request that blacks and whites start on opposite ends of the bus. Whites sit from the front to the middle, and blacks from the back to the middle until the bus is full. Blacks would not be forced to give up their seats for white passengers. 2. Bus drivers need to stop on every corner in black neighborhoods just like they do for white neighborhoods. And 3. Blacks need to be able to get from their seats to the front of the, from the front of the bus.
Those are some big demands.
Yes, they are. And if they aren't implemented, then I can promise you that not only the Women's Political Council, but the NAACP and several other groups will organize the black community to boycott city buses.
Now, Miss Robinson, that is drastic measures. I'm sure we can work something out.
I'm glad to hear that.
Outside Booker T. Washington High School, Claudette walks out of school with a group of students chatting. Claudette balances her school books and a canvas bag in her hands. As Claudette and her friends approach the bus stop, she pulls away from them.
I'll see you guys tomorrow. I'm gonna walk to the rec center for my crochet group.
That's a few miles. You don't want to ride the bus closer?
Nah, I'm gonna save my money and just walk. It's not that far anyway.
On the sidewalk, Claudette walks along the street. Sounds of a baseball game are in the distance, steadily getting louder. At the baseball field, Claudette stands on the other side of the fence from a baseball game. The small crowd watching cheers as a player hits a ball into the outfield. One spectator, a light-skinned black man in his 20s, turns to watch Claudette watch the game. She catches his eye, and they share a smile. Inside Booker T. Washington High School classroom, the classroom is stark. There are rows of desks, and Claudette sits at one of them in the front. Miss Nesbitt, a pretty young teacher, stands in front of Claudette, leaning on her teacher's desk.
Do you know why I asked you to stay after class today?
Because I was talking with Janet too much during math.
Well, I should have kept you both for that, but no. You've made honor roll again. There will be a ceremony next week.
Oh, that is boss.
Claudette jumps out of her seat.
My parents are going to be so excited.
Yes, please invite your great aunt and uncle. You live with them, right?
They are my parents, only parents I've ever really known.
I'm sorry. Then please invite your parents. The junior year honor roll is very important for determining what classes you'll be in next year, and that, of course, helps with college.
In the Colvin home front room, Claudette stands on a piece of brown paper, and her mother does something around her bare feet. Upon closer inspection, we see Mary is tracing the outline of Claudette's feet onto the paper. Mary stands on the same piece of paper, their roles reversed, with Claudette tracing her feet. Now Claudette sits at a table cutting out the outlines of their feet. Outside Montgomery Ward department store, it is a repeat of an earlier scene, the two of them hand in hand crossing the street. They go to the same, colored only, marked side door. Inside the Montgomery Ward department store in the shoe department, the store is brightly lit with predominantly white people shopping. Mary and Claudette browse through the shoes, careful not to pick any up.
Why do I need new shoes anyway? Shopping for them is always such a hassle.
Your shoes are falling apart, Claudette. I don't want you going out there with shoes that are talking to everyone so people think I can't take care of you.
Everyone knows you take good care of me, Mama.
And everyone is going to know I can take care of you well enough to get you new shoes, too. What about these?
Claudette comes over to look at the shoes her mother indicates.
Those are really cute.
Mary waves over a sales lady, but is ignored. This happens a few more times. Claudette gets visibly irritated at the lack of service. She steps in front of a passing clerk.
Excuse me, we need help over here?
The clerk, a young white woman who looks put out at having Claudette approach her, but with a sigh, she follows. Mary glares at Claudette, but turns to the clerk.
Can we get a pair of these in a size 8 to try?
Right away, ma'am.
Claudette, you know better than to get up and wipe people's faces like that.
I got us some service, though, didn't I?
The clerk returns.
Do you have an outline to test the shoes with?
Mary digs in her purse and pulls out the foot outlines we previously saw the women make. The clerk takes the paper with her fingertips. It is a movement of disdain. She lines up the paper to the bottom of the shoe to make sure they are the same size. Out on the sidewalk, Claudette is walking down the same street as before. Again, we hear the echoes of a baseball game in progress. At the baseball field, Claudette sits alone on the benches. There are people all around her, but she is in her own world enjoying the game. She whoops and hollers at hits and bad calls. She is thoroughly entranced in the game. As she watches the game, the light-skinned man that smiled at her earlier comes to sit down next to her. Closer up, the man is obviously handsome. He is so light that he is almost white passing, just a few shades too dark to full pass.
Great game, ain't it?
Claudette keeps her eyes on the game.
Only if you ignore how blind the ref is.
She looks to see who sat next to her and quickly looks back to the field, embarrassed.
Safe to say you're a Warriors fan?
Yeah, I've been a fan of them since I moved to Montgomery. You like the Jets?
I did, but if a girl as cute as you is a Warriors fan, I just may have to switch teams.
Nah, you root for your sorry Jets and I'll root for my amazing Warriors. When we root for different teams, that makes the game more fun. I mean, if you want to. You ain't got to stay sitting with me or anything.
I'm the one that chose to sit here. Saw this pretty girl and had to be near her.
That's the second time you called me pretty.
Is it? Must be true then.
What's your name?
Raymond. Most people just call me Ray. What's yours? Is it as pretty as you?
That's the third time, and my name is Claudette.
I was right. Your name is just as pretty as you.
Fourth.
You better believe if we keep talking, I'm going to call you pretty a million more times.
Claudette smiles down at her hands, embarrassed but pleased.
And he is so cute. I think I'm already totally gone for him, Mackie Horse.
Outside the Colvin home at night, Claudette stands outside her home brushing the horse's flank. The stars are out in full force, twinkling a lifetime away. A full moon shines down, lighting the area. The only help it gets is the glow from light inside the house, coming through a side window.
He is older, but he sees a maturity in me that he says makes our age difference not matter. The big thing is he is married. Him and his wife are separated, but still, what should I do, Mac?
On the sidewalk during the day, Claudette chats with Annie and a couple other friends as they each board the bus. The white section is empty, so they are able to go straight back without getting back off the bus. Super, March 2nd, 1955. In the bus, Claudette and three of her friends sit in the first row of the black section. Claudette at the window seat. Claudette carefully places her stack of school books in her lap. The bus continues down the road. As the bus goes on, the front fills up. They stop at the Court Square bus stop, and a white woman boards the bus and goes straight to Claudette's row. The bus driver looks in his rearview mirror and sees where the woman has stopped.
I'll need those seats.
Annie and Claudette's two other friends get up and move to stand further back. Claudette does not get up.
Why are you still sitting, girl? Get up.
You heard him. You need to get up.
She ain't gotta do nothing.
The white woman continues to stand over Claudette, waiting for the seat. Cut to the bus driver, continues his route and gets to the next bus stop. Claudette watches the bus driver get off the bus as more people load on. He goes to the transit police. Claudette can't hear them, but sees the driver point towards her. A pregnant black woman, Mrs. Hamilton, sits next to Claudette, unaware of the unfolding drama. The driver and transit police board. The transit police makes his way to the two women.
You two need to get up.
Mrs. Hamilton puts a hand over her stomach.
I'm tired, sir.
You can't make me
standing up for this ride.
The transit police looks uncomfortable. He glances at the Mrs. Hamilton's pregnant belly and then at the crowd of black riders.
None of you men give her your seat for pregnant lady.
Two black men jump up from their seats and get off the bus through the back door. They want no part of this. Mrs. Hamilton looks at Claudette uncertainly and slowly gets up to sit in one of the newly vacated seats.
Now, you get up too.
No, sir.
I said get up.
No, sir.
He looks back at the bus driver, then back at Claudette. He turns and walks back to where the driver is standing in the front.
I don't have the authority to arrest her. I can have the police waiting at the next bus stop, though.
The bus driver nods and the transit police leaves. Cut to the bus continuing down the road. Cut to the bus pulling up to another stop. Claudette sees two police officers standing next to the crowd of waiting would-be riders.
Oh, that's the girl.
The two officers board the bus. Oh, I knew that thing. We've had trouble with it before. They walk to where Claudette sits.
Ain't you gonna get up, girl?
No, sir.
Get up! Tears start streaming down Claudette's face.
No, sir. It is my constitutional right to sit here as much as it is that lady's.
Get up now.
I paid my fare just like she did. It is my constitutional right to sit here.
The two police officers each grab Claudette by an arm and pull her from the seat. Her school books go flying. Claudette lets her body go limp in their hands. They drag her off the bus.
It's my constitutional right. You can't make me give up my seat.
At the bus stop, the police drag Claudette through a watching crowd to their squad car. They throw her in.
Stick your hands through the window.
Claudette complies and he slaps handcuffs onto her wrists. In the squad car, Officer Headley climbs into the driver's seat and Officer Ward sits next to Claudette. She keeps her eyes straight ahead.
Big tits for an ape. What do you think, Smith? 34C?
At least.
Claudette closes her eyes as tears trail down her face.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
You think God can save you? God is on the rightful side, the side of the greater race.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
I bet you're a whore. all you darkies are whores, ready, needy for a superior white cock.
On earth, as it is in heaven.
In the jailhouse, Claudette is frisked by a male officer. He takes the opportunity to grope her and make her as uncomfortable as possible. Cut to Claudette is fingerprinted. Cut to Claudette holds a placard with her booking number, 7321. The light from a camera flashes and she turns. The light flashes again. Cut to the jailhouse cell. The jail cell is small, bare walls, a dingy toilet and cot, with no sheets, are just as gray as the cement walls and floor. The cell door slams behind Claudette and a strangled cry escapes her. She's crying in earnest now. She looks around, taking in her surroundings. Claudette walks further in the room and stumbles to the ground. She stays kneeling there and starts to pray.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Sorry. Outside the Colvin home, Annie runs through a rundown poor neighborhood. She stops at the Colvin home and beats on the door.
Mrs. Colvin! Mrs. Colvin!
Mary opens the door, drying her hands on a dish towel.
Annie? What is wrong with you, child? Banging on my door, screaming like the devil himself is on your tail.
Mrs. Colvin, Claudette's been arrested.
What? Slow down. What happened with Claudette?
She refused to give up her seat to a white lady, and they done arrested her.
The dish towel falls from Mary's hand to the ground. In the jailhouse, Mary and Reverend Johnson rush through the lobby to the front desk.
Where is my daughter? Give her back to me now.
The police is a little taken aback and reaches to his side, going for his baton. Reverend Johnson pulls Mary back.
I'm sorry, sir. My friend is just very worried about her daughter.
Mary stifles a wail and buries herself into the Reverend Johnson's shoulder.
Can we please have any information about a Miss Claudette Colvin? She was arrested about an hour ago.
The police looks harder at Reverend Johnson before nodding and turning to look through some paperwork. He comes back with a single police report in his hand.
15-year-old Claudette Colvin arrested for breaking segregation laws, disorderly conduct, and assault and battery.
Mary wails louder this time, hearing the charges.
Yes, sir, I do believe that's her.
She has bail set at $10 with a $4 court fee. Can you pay that?
Reverend Johnson reaches into his pocket for a money clip. In the jailhouse cell, Mary and Reverend Johnson follow the same police officer down the corridor to Claudette's cell. She is in the same position we left her in, kneeling in the center of the cell.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation.
Claudette!
Mary breaks away from the men and runs to the cell. Her hands clutch the bars. Claudette breaks off from her prayer and looks up. She pushes to her feet and rushes to her mother. Her hands cover her mother's.
My baby, my poor sweet baby.
Mama, I'm so sorry.
The police unlocks the cell door and opens it.
You're being released into the care of your mother, little girl.
Claudette dashes out of the cell and clings to her mother in a hug. In Reverend Johnson's car, the car ride is silent. No radio on. No one speaks. Claudette is still in shock, and Mary doesn't know what to say or do.
I want you to know, no matter what happens after this, I'm proud of you. You did the right thing today.
Reverend, we should not be encouraging her to put herself in danger like that.
She is in danger just by being born with dark skin. Better for her to stand up for her rights rather than let these people walk all over her like she's less than a dog.
Mary is silent.
Claudette, everyone prays for freedom. We've all been praying and praying. But you're different. You want your answer the next morning. And I think you just brought the revolution to Montgomery, and that is not a thing to be dismissed.
In Claudette's room, Claudette lays in bed. Her eyes are wide and terrified. A sound from outside makes her stiffen, just the wind blowing. In the front room, QP sits in his chair in the dark. Only the moon lights the room. A shotgun rests in his lap. Mary shuffles into the room. She sees QP and goes over to the window, peeking out.
Get back from the window, woman. You know how good a target you make for a brink to come flying through.
Do you really think they'll come after us?
She closes the curtains and backs away from the window.
Never know what kind of stuff the clan will do.
She's just a child, though. They can't get mad at a silly child.
You really think that their word is the child?
Mary wrings her hands together.
Just go to bed, Mary. I'll keep watch tonight.
Mary opens her mouth to protest, but shakes her head instead and goes to bed. In Booker T. Washington High School in the hallway, Claudette walks through the hallways alone. She clutches her book, scared of what other reactions will be to her arrest.
Claudette, how are you?
Annie runs up to Claudette, grinning. She doesn't give her friend the chance to speak.
Everyone is flipping over you standing up to those cops. It's all anyone could talk about.
Really? People think it's a good thing?
Of course they do. It is the wildest thing to happen around here in so long.
Inside NAACP headquarters, Rosa's office. Rosa sits at her desk sorting through paperwork. A knock sounds on her door.
Come in.
Miss Parks, I got the mail for you today. Looks like that Colvin girl got a lot more letters today.
He holds up a sack filled with letters.
Just set it over there with the other letters for her, please.
Mailboy puts the sack next to three sacks that are just the same. In the conference room, a throng of people fill the small conference room, including Martin Luther King Jr., Rosa, Joanne, the head of the Montgomery NAACP E.D. Nixon, and a young lawyer, Fred Gray. There is a loud discussion, people talking over each other. Everyone's trying to figure out the NAACP's next move.
We can't continue as we are. The bus situation is getting out of hand. That girl that was arrested the other day,
Claudette Colvin, Mr. Nixon.
Yes, her, Claudette. Reports say she was visibly dragged off the bus and verbally abused. These are our children. They were putting themselves in danger while we adults cower in fear.
We need to do something. We told the mayor months ago that we would boycott if he didn't do something to improve the bus situation.
Well, this Claudette girl, the kind of girl we can rally behind.
Everyone turns to Rosa.
She is a very devout Christian and a passionate member of the youth council. Sometimes a bit too passionate. She is a good kid, but she is still a kid. Can we really put this kind of pressure on a child?
Discussions rise up again, people talking over each other. Over the noise, Gray raises his voice.
We don't have to decide right now, do we? It's better to go into this cautiously instead of rushing after it. Rushing leads to mistakes, and we can't afford that. How about I represent the child in her court case and we go from there?
In the Colvin home front room that night, Gray sits at a couch with Mary. QP sits in his chair, and Claudette sits on the floor, facing the couch.
If I represent Claudette, we could try and fight this. There's no need to plead guilty for something you were wrong for.
I wasn't planning on pleading guilty. I know my constitutional rights.
I've heard you do. And you're right. The segregation laws are unjust, and we must fight them against them in any way we can.
How much is all this going to cost us? We ain't got money to be spending on fancy lawyers.
Well, sir, between donations that have come in on Claudette's behalf to the NAACP and the organization, you won't have to pay me a shiny penny.
Forgive me, but that sounds a little too good to be true.
The whole point of the NAACP is to help people. We want to help you.
And you will help me fight for my rights.
I'm certainly going to try.
Claudette looks between her parents. They look back at her. She settles her eyes square into Gray's.
Then let's do it. I want to fight.
I love that spirit. I need your parents' permission, though.
We give it.
If your girl wants to fight for what she believes in, then we support her.
In the courthouse courtroom, the courtroom is large and spacious. Dark wood floors with matching dark wood benches covering it. The walls have large arch-to-floor-to-ceiling windows. An empty jury box sits by the windows. The rest of the seats are sparsely filled. The judge sits on his bench. Claudette and Gray sit at the defendant's table. Officer Ward is in the witness box. The prosecutor leans against the box, relaxed.
She was a little hellion.
Officer Ward turns to the judge and gives a conspiratorial smile.
Pardon my language, sir. She was kicking and scratching while yelling her head off about being just as good as white folks, if not better.
Cut to Annie is now in the witness box. The prosecutor paces in front of her.
Claudette wouldn't get up, but she didn't lay a hand on those cops. They were the ones hurting her. At first she was quiet, talking at maybe a little lower than normal tones. It wasn't until they started dragging her off the bus that she started yelling about her rights, and even then, she ain't fight back.
Annie glances over to where Claudette sits fidgeting.
The police were so violent. Me and other students were scared they would come after all of us.
Cut two. The judge sits on the bench looking down at the assembled group before him.
Hearing the testimonies of both sides and reading the police report, I rule that Claudette Colvin is guilty of all charges.
Protests erupts in the courtroom. Claudette lets out a gut-wrenching howl in grief, tears rushing down her face. You can hear the pain and fear in her cries. Judge Hill bangs his gavel.
Settle down. I will have order in my court.
The courtroom settles down until only the cries of Claudette can be heard.
I declare Miss Colvin a ward of the state to be released in the care of her parents, and she will be placed on probation for the next year. Court dismissed.
In the hallways of Booker T. Washington High School, Claudette walks with Annie down the hall of her school. Where there were once cheers for her, there are now jeers.
There she is. That's the girl who was arrested.
It's my constitutional right.
Students laugh, and Claudette hangs her head in shame.
All she's doing is making things tough for the rest of us. Now the police are going to look closer at teens.
Claudette ducks into the closest classroom. Miss Nesbitt looks up at Claudette's sudden entrance.
Claudette, class isn't for another 10 minutes.
Oh, sorry, Miss Nesbitt. I couldn't be out in the halls anymore.
What's wrong?
Nothing. Everything. I don't know.
How about you take a seat and tell me why you're hiding out in my classroom?
Claudette moves to one of the seats in the front of the classroom. She lays her head on the desk.
The kids are making fun of me because of the bus thing.
Lift your head up and look at me.
Claudette reluctantly and slowly lifts her head up.
Now, those kids may be making fun of you because of this bus thing, but you have to look at it this way. You made history. People are going to remember you as the girl that finally stood up to discrimination by sitting down. People aren't going to forget that. Mark my words, you have started something that is bigger than you. I'm proud of you more than you could imagine. I'm sure your parents are proud of you, too. Remember that. Remember, you did something worthy of being proud of.
In the Colvin home, in the kitchen, music is playing. Something upbeat like 17 by Boyd Bennett and his Rockets of Chuck Berry's Maybelline. Mary and Claudette dance around the kitchen, singing along and laughing. Claudette's hair is wet and it's in its natural afro state. The stove is on with a hot comb resting on the flame. Mary dances over to Claudette and pulls her close to dance together. Hair gets into Mary's face. She pulls her head back.
Oh, girl, I can't wait to get your hair straightened again. It's so nappy.
Claudette touched her hair.
My teacher, Miss Lawrence, is from Africa, and she never straightens her hair.
They let her work at the school looking like that?
Uh-huh. I like it. She says we shouldn't spend all our time trying to look white when white people don't care about us.
So what, you gonna start wearing your hair nappy like that?
A serene smile ghosts across Claudette's face.
That's a great idea, Mom. I'm not straightening my hair anymore. We shouldn't spend hours trying to look like them. We are a beautiful people. I'm not going to straighten my hair until they see us as equals.
Mary shakes her head.
Don't come running to me when the kids at school make fun of you and make you regret your choice.
The kids at school already make fun of me, so there's nothing much else they can do to me. Anyway, who cares what they think? I'm going to look good with my nappy hair.
At the baseball field, Claudette is at yet another game. This time, Ray is already with her. The crack of a ball hitting a bat sounds. Ray jumps to his feet, cheering. Claudette boos. The boo is only half-hearted, though. Ray laughs.
Don't be a sore loser.
The game isn't over yet. We still have a chance to come back.
You haven't been having a great time.
Yes, I am.
No, you ain't. Something more than Warriors losing is on your mind. Something to do with the arrest?
Claudette stays silent.
Come on.
Ray stands up and reaches out his hand.
Let's get out of here and go somewhere more private to talk. You can tell me all your worries and tell me why you changed your hair.
She takes his hand and smiles.
Like it?
Love it. Now let's scoot out of here.
In Ray's home in the front room, the room is small and a little messy. A threadbare couch on one wall and a curio with a few dishes in it on the opposite wall. A dinged up wooden coffee table sits immediately in front of the couch. Ray opens the door from outside and ushers Claudette in. She looks around in curiosity.
So this is your home?
My mother's house, but since me and my wife split up, I've been staying here. You can sit over there. I'll get us some lemonade.
Ray disappears through a door, and Claudette gingerly sits on the very edge of the couch. A moment later, Ray comes out with two glasses of lemonade so cold, the glass is wet with condensation. He hands Claudette a glass and sits down next to her, looking much more comfortable and at home than she does.
So tell me what's been bothering you.
The glasses are... Fade two. The glasses are half empty and left abandoned on the coffee table. Ray hugs Claudette close to him. Silent tears run down her face. Her face is one a lot of recent crying.
Baby, you don't need to worry about what none of those kids say. Your teacher's right. You should be proud. I'm proud of you.
Yeah, I don't understand how painfully lonely it is to have everyone around you hate you.
Don't know everyone around you hate you. I know your mama don't. Sound like that teacher of yours don't either.
Ray pulls away and looks at Claudette. He lays a hand on her cheek, wiping away a tear.
And I know for sure I'm far from hating you.
Ray leans down and captures Claudette in a kiss. She is still and unsure. Shoulders tense, but they relax as she melts into the kiss. In the Colvin home kitchen, Rosa and Mary sit at the kitchen table across from a crying Claudette. There is a creaking, oscillating metal fan on a counter working hard to take away the summer heat.
Child, what is wrong with you?
Call us both here and then just cry your heart out. Did something happen? It's summer. Are those kids from school still harassing you?
Mama, Mrs. Parks, I don't know how to tell y'all.
Tell us what? No matter what it is, we will try and help you, but you gotta tell us what is wrong.
I'm late.
Late? Late for what?
My lady times. They ain't come in 3 months.
Oh, my Lord.
3 months?
Claudette starts crying harder.
3 months and you just now telling us? Child, what in the devil possessed you to keep a secret for so long?
Hold on, Mary. She is pregnant, and there's nothing we can do to change that. Right now, we need to find out who the father is.
Claudette vehemently shakes her head so hard her glasses start to slide down her nose.
I'm not telling.
Oh, you're gonna tell, and then this boy is gonna do right by you.
I ain't telling, and wild horses dragging me couldn't get it out of me.
Inside the NAACP headquarters conference room, yet again, Nixon, Gray, Joanne, Rosa, MLK, and others are gathered and talking over each other. They are still talking about what to do about buses.
We took Claudette's case to appeal, but he still upheld the verdict. We can use this as a starting point.
Starting point for what? We haven't even settled on what our end goal here is.
You threatened that we would boycott if there wasn't change. We should hold them to it.
Other cities have tried and failed to boycott. If we were to do it, it would require lots of planning and someone that the people can rally behind.
We have Claudette.
I'm sure Claudette is a sweet girl, but the people won't rally behind her.
Why not?
I hate to say it, but we need someone even white folks couldn't hate. And Claudette is from the wrong part of town, the wrong skin color, and the wrong age. Everything about her is wrong.
The wrong skin color? Brother, we're all the wrong skin color here.
Yeah, but we aren't all dark skin. White folks won't support a dark-skinned girl. Rosa fidgets before speaking up.
And she is pregnant now. She can start showing at any time.
There is no way either community would fight for an unwed, pregnant, dark-skinned, poor, teenaged girl.
So what do we do?
We find someone else to give to the public.
In the Booker T. Washington High School hallway, a student we do not know half runs down the hallway. The soles of her shoes clack in the empty hall. She stops at a door and raises her hand. In the classroom, Miss Mesbit stands at the chalkboard writing.
Phyllis Wheatley was the first Negro poet. Many people didn't believe a Negro could write such beautiful things, but...
A knock resounds from the door.
Come in.
The same girl from the hall steps in.
Sorry to interrupt your class, ma'am, but the principal wants Claudette Colvin come to his office immediately.
The class of juveniles all echo an oh and laugh.
Everyone be quiet. Miss Colvin, you heard her. To the principal's office.
Claudette gets up and gathers her things to follow the girl. In the principal's office, Mr. Smiley, the principal, sits behind his desk, his face a mask of stern concern. Claudette sits in front of him, hands clasped and facing down.
Do you know why I called you down here today, Miss Colvin?
Claudette's hands tighten into fists. She fights back tears, but we can't hear it. But we can hear it in her voice.
Yes, sir. You don't have to say it.
We know you're pregnant. We have a zero tolerance rule.
I know, sir.
Then you also know that means expulsion.
Yes, sir.
Smiley looks at her, and his shoulders sag.
I could allow you to finish up the semester, since there are only a couple weeks left, but do not come back after the Christmas break.
Outside the Colvin home at night, it would be a peaceful night if not for the heated conversation spilling out into the night air.
Pregnant? The hell does a child get pregnant?
Calm down, we were going to tell you and we had a plan.
In the Colvin home front room, QP paces back and forth through the room. Mary and Claudette sit huddled together on the couch watching him.
A plan? What kind of plan did you have? I hope it involved Mary and this boy. Who is it anyway?
Claudette was going to finish the semester and then go down to Birmingham with her mother for the rest of the pregnancy without anyone knowing. We can still do that, but she won't be able to come back and finish school.
Mary turns to the quiet Claudette.
As for who the boy is...
I'm not telling. I can't marry him anyway.
What's wrong with him that you can't marry him?
He already got a wife?
Mary stiffens and pulls away. QP stops his pacing and stares at Claudette.
They not together anymore, but they still married.
So he is older?
Claudette nods. Jesus Christ.
We can still use her plan. She can go down to Birmingham, have the baby, then finish school there. Get her out of town and away from this man. The less people that know about this, the better.
In the bus, Rosa Parks sits in the first row of the colored section with three other black passengers. Two or three white passengers stand in the aisle in front of her. Super reads, December 1st, 1955. The bus stops, and the bus driver walks to the back of the bus to where Rosa sits. He moves the colored sign to the row behind Rosa.
I need you all move back. Let these people sit.
Rosa and the other three stay in their seats.
I said get up. I don't want to have cold police on y'all.
The three passengers get up and move to stand further back on the bus. Rosa stays sitting.
Lady, why won't you just stand up?
I don't think I should have to stand.
If you don't get up, I'm going to have to call the police.
Well, you go ahead and do what you feel you need to do, sir.
In the NAACP headquarters conference room, the usual group gathers yet again to discuss the handling of buses.
This is our chance. We can sue the city, get them to change things.
They didn't charge Rosa with breaking segregation laws.
So we use this as our chance to boycott. We have everything ready. We just needed a face.
Miss Parks would be a great person to stand behind.
Me?
Yes. No one can say you aren't respectable.
Everyone turns to examine Rosa.
So we do the boycott with Rosa at the head?
I'm not sure I'm the right choice.
Rosa, we'll all be here right beside you every step of the way.
We need you. Who knows when someone like you will be available again?
Rosa wrings her hands.
I just did it because I was tired of this going on. I'm just so tired. So if being the face of the boycott is what will help end this, then I'll do it.
Outside the Colvin home, QP sits in the driver's seat of a car. Mary stands in the doorway, crying. Claudette stands with her, a suitcase in her hand. Her baby bump is unable to be hidden at 6 months.
I don't want to go.
Well, you have to. Now you can see our actions have consequences.
I didn't even know doing that could make a baby.
Now you know. Get in the car before your daddy gets annoyed.
Mary leans over and kisses Claudette on the cheek. She lays her hand in her daughter's hair and smiles at her.
Be good. Down there.
Yes, ma'am. I love you.
I love you too. Now, get.
Claudette goes to the car and sticks her bag in the back seat before climbing in on the passenger side. QP backs out of the driveway and drives off. Mary stands in the doorway and watches until she can no longer see the car. And then we take a break.
All right, cool. I'm glad you said it because I didn't even notice that we were at the intermission. So we're going to take a quick 5-minute break and we will be right back.
What y'all? Everything got out in the box, though.
Press the button to begin. All my life, me ever have my gun, so me have to move sharp like me knife. All my life, me pray say when me get wealthy, I'm a and me wife. All my life. This thing force me fi be a killer just like Rodney Price. All my life, nah, all my life. One tear Kobe, some boy don't know me. Though I'm rough, them can't believe a grandma drew me.
Know a few popcorn songs, oh, and feel them know me. 4 miles me used to walk to school, them know man's story. Ha! Oh, me gain up all those glory. The world is man, the whole light me taking slowly. Happy days me call it, now my bones had story. Anyway, me de- in that the world, my dogs them roll me. Me laugh and collect those trophies. Me call me deserve everything my music give me. Boy, unruly, no light like frisbee. The dream, family leave that with me. Oh, 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 oh. All my life, me dream for who knows. Land, cars and bikes. All my life,
I'm in a staking bar, I got this. I'm a debaser.
All my life,
saddened about to my love, and I'm just a heartbreaker.
All
I won't get a take in, cause I'm out when I'm staking. And I'm I'm breaking, I'm making you a personal day. Cars and bikes. All my life, I'm in a staking bar, I got this. I'm a debaser.
All my life,
saddened about to my love, and I'm just a heartbreaker.
All
I won't get a take in, cause I'm out when I'm staking. And I'm I'm breaking, I'm making you a personal day.
Thank you.
all my life. Me ever have my gun, so me have to move sharp like me knife. All my life. Me pray say when me get wealthy, I'm a and me wife. All my life. This system force me fi be a killer just like Rodney Price. All my life. Nah, all my life.
One tear Kobe, some boy don't know me. Though I'm rough, them can't believe a grandma drew me. Know a few popcorn songs, oh, I feel them know me. 4 miles me used to walk a school, them know man's story. Ha! Now me gain up all those glory. The world is man, the whole light me taking slowly. Happy days me call it, now my bones had story. Anyway, me the in that the world, my dogs them roll me. Ha ha ha! Me laugh and collect those trophies. Me call me deserve everything what music give me. Boy, unruly no light like frisbee. The dream, family leave that with me. Oh, 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 oh. All my life, me dream for who knows. Land, cars and bikes. All my life,
I'm in a staking bar, I got this. I'm at the base of
all my life.
Deciding about to my love, and I'm just a heartbreaker.
All
I won't
life.
Get a take in, cause I'm out when I'm staking.
All right, and we are back after intermission. We're going to continue now with part two of Court Square by Tracy Ann Canada. Just a reminder, you can submit a script for us to perform as well by going to twitchtablereads.com. Let's revisit our table readers. Un momento. Hey guys, ready to go? Hello, hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hey guys. I am back, so I'm just going to assume that everybody is there. We're going to pick up where we left off. Cheddar, take it away.
On the road, the car drives down an empty country highway. Claudette stares out the window as the trees and wild grass go by. In an Austin home, the Austin home, the house is smaller and shabbier than the Colvin home.
Cheddarman, EL, Erica, are you here, guys?
Yeah, we all said we were here. Well,
I thought Mish said take it away.
Really?
Okay. In the Austin home, the house is smaller and shabbier than the Colvin home. Claudette sits on the couch. Mary Jane, a black woman in her 40s, stands in front of Claudette. She wrings her hands and shuffles foot to foot.
If there's anything you need, I can get it for you.
Thank you, Miss Austin.
Oh, you could call me Mama if you want.
A flash of distaste flashes across Claudette's face before she schools it back to a neutral expression.
That is very kind of you, but I think I'll feel more comfortable calling you Miss Austin.
Later in the Austin home, it's a different day, and Claudette is more comfortable in the Austin home. She lays on the same couch she sat on before. Her back is against the armrest and she is knitting a baby blanket, the finished portion resting on her increasingly obvious stomach. Music plays on the radio. Mary Jane sweeps the room.
Are you sure I can't help, Miss Austin? I feel bad just sitting here while you work.
Oh no, child. You're getting big pregnant now and I remember how my feet and back hurt when I was big with you. You're probably the same way, am I right? You just sit there and do your knitting. That baby's gonna need something to keep it warm.
Claudette sighs and turns back to her knitting. Mary continues sweeping, leaving the room. The song on the radio ends and there is static. Then, a radio host speaks.
That was no more from the McGuire sisters. Those girls sure can sing. In Montgomery, it's been 2 weeks since there was a rise in Negroes refusing to ride the bus. They say it's an effort to get the segregation laws changed after the arrests and not guilty pleas of Rosa Parks and Claudette Colbert.
Claudette throws her knitting to the floor.
Colbert? They are doing a boycott, claiming me as part of it, and I never even knew about it.
Mary Jane walks back into the room.
What are you going on about in here?
Everybody from the NAACP has tossed me aside ever since I lost my appeal, but they want to use me as part of a boycott and didn't tell me a thing about it, and they couldn't even contact someone to try and get my name right. They calling me Claudette Colbert.
Ain't no reason to get mad at that. Not like you could be up there getting into more trouble fooling around with them processes. You ain't missing nothing up there. They'll be back on the bus in a day or two when they get tired of walking. Just you wait.
Nah, I don't want to miss out on any more. I needs to be there.
You needs to be getting your rest.
Claudette goes to the front door.
I'm going down the road to use the phone. I'm calling Papa QP to pick me up.
On the Birmingham streets, crowds of black people are on the road. They walk in groups, some carrying loads of groceries overflowing from their arms. Everyone is weary. A bus drives by. It is noticeably empty. Inside a church. The church is packed, more packed than any Sunday. The people are just as riled up as they are on an Easter Sunday. They stand and cheer as the sermon-like speech goes on. On the pulpit is Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. It's been a hard month. Our feet are weary. Our days are long. But we are still pressing forward because we know that we aren't just walking for ourselves.
No, sir, we aren't.
No, we are walking for our future generations, for our children, for our children's children, so that none of them ever have to suffer the indignities the bus companies try to force on us.
Yes, sir.
Yes, yes, sir.
Amen. Amen.
Claudette sits in the very last pew. She is slouched down, hoping no one takes notice of her. Her stomach is too big to be hidden any longer, but she wears a big sweater attempting to hide it. She absentmindedly rubs her stomach when he mentions doing it for the children. This mass meeting is to reassure you that the bus companies cannot last long. They are losing money every day without us. We hold that kind of power. They just never wanted us to know that. As the great Langston Hughes has told us, life is no crystal stair, but nonetheless, we must keep going. He says for us not to set down on those stairs because we find a kinder heart. We must take this to heart. We can't fall now. We must push on. The promised land is near. Claudette nods her head along as he speaks. In the NAACP headquarters, in the conference room, Fred Gray stands in front of MLK, Rosa Parks, Nixon, and Joanne, who are sitting at the conference table.
The boycott's drawing a lot of eyes to Birmingham. We have to do more. It may get us a few concessions, like not being forced to give up our seats eventually, but I think we could go for more.
More like what?
Like the desegregation of buses altogether.
Talk bursts out from around the table, some in agreement with Fred, others not.
Everyone, let's settle down. We still need to hear what Mr. Gray actually has to say.
Thank you, Mrs. Parks. I know there are cases we can gather together for a class action suit against the city. We can make them go further than any boycott would with a legal case.
What exactly would you be suing them for?
Breaking our constitutional rights. There's a precedent if we frame it the right way.
Well, I think it is a fine idea. We told Gail that if he didn't give in, we would boycott. Now we're 2 months into the boycott and nothing is happening so far. Let's show him we're serious. Suing him would get us everything we want. May help end up helping other cities too.
Okay then. What do you all think? Inside Fred Gray's office at night. Fred Gray sits alone at a desk. It is night and only a single desk lamp lights his area. There is paper and open books littered all over the desk. Fred hunches over and reads one paper in one hand, then switches attention to another paper in his other hand. He mutters to himself as he reads.
He pleaded guilty so he can't join. So did she.
Fred shuffles through more papers.
I'll talk to her. She could end up being viable. I'll add it to the list with Miss Smith.
He sets one page to the side. In the Colvin home kitchen, Claudette sits at the kitchen table with a book open in front of her.
I don't know why I gotta study. Ain't like I'm in school anymore.
Mary stands at the stove stirring a pot.
You ain't gonna be out of school forever. As soon as you have that baby, you're going back down to Montgomery and finishing school. This baby ain't gonna stop that, so you might as well quit belly aching and study so you don't fall too far behind.
Claudette sighs and props her head on her hand, staring blankly at the book. There is a knock on the door. She pops up and runs to the door.
I'll get it.
Mary sighs and shakes her head. In the front room, Claudette opens the door and Fred Gray stands there.
Good afternoon, Miss Claudette.
Claudette looks at him with barely concealed hostility.
Oh, you guys...
Sorry.
Oh, you guys remember who I am now?
Mary walks into the room.
Claudette, stop being rude. Don't think you're too old for me to swat that behind of yours, pregnant or not. Good afternoon, Mr. Gray. Please come in. How are you?
Fred steps through into the house. Claudette closes the door behind him.
I'm fine, Mrs. Colvin. Be even better when this city gives in to our demands and this whole boycott can end.
Amen to that. We're lucky we have a car and QP can drive me to work, but many others out there are lucky.
We have a carpool set up for those who can afford to chip in, but way too many are still having to walk many miles a day to and from work and everything else they need. That's actually what I'm here for today.
Huh? What's that then?
Me and some of the others in the NAACP are thinking it might be a fine idea to sue the city.
For what?
The way we see it, if it's unconstitutional to have segregated schools, then segregated public transportation should be the same way.
Claudette scoffs.
You from up north, Mr. Gray. But down here, schools are still segregated. They ain't gonna listen.
We're gonna make them listen, even if we have to take it up to the highest courts in the land.
Do you really think that will do anything?
Yes, ma'am, I do.
But why did you come here? What do you have to do with any... What do we have to do with any of that fancy suing stuff?
Claudette, we want you to be a part of it.
Me?
You are one of the few people to ever plead not guilty, so I'll be suing on your behalf.
What would I need to do?
I will do most of the work. You can just relax and prepare for your bundle of joy. When the time comes, you'll go to court and testify about what happened to you.
That's it.
That's it?
But last time we told them what happened, it didn't matter. They didn't believe me over the police.
This time will be different. Trust me, I'll make sure it is.
Claudette turns to her mother.
Ma, may I?
You're going to be the one having to deal with people, not me. This is a decision you're going to have to make for yourself.
Claudette turns back to Fred.
I've been trying to fight for my rights all by myself. I never had help. Last time y'all said you were going to help me, you disappeared.
I'm truly sorry for that. I can promise you that it won't happen this time. We'll be with you every step of the way.
Claudette glances back at her mother before locking eyes with Fred.
Okay, then. Count me in.
Over black, the sounds of a woman screaming in pain are sudden and shocking.
Come on, you can do it!
More screams.
Push! Take a deep breath and push!
In the hospital room, Claudette, sweaty, face scrunched up, clutches Mary's hand. Mary leans over Claudette, brushing hair out of her face.
I can't do it, Mama. I can't push no more.
Yes, you can, baby. Every woman has gone through this before. You are made of tough stuff, and you will get through it, too.
Claudette screams. The wails of a baby are heard. In the hospital room, Claudette has been cleaned up. She's resting, half asleep, with Mary and QP sitting in chairs next to the bed. Mary is still holding Claudette's hand. A nurse comes in holding a baby. It is swaddled so the audience cannot see it.
It's time for his feeding.
Mary shakes Claudette gently.
It's time to feed the baby. You gotta wake up now.
Claudette slowly wakes up. The nurse places the baby in her arms, and we see it looks white with blonde hair and blue eyes.
Are you sure the man you was with was black?
Claudette sighs.
Yes, Mama.
She looks down at the baby in her arms.
I'm sure he will get darker as time goes on.
Have you decided on a name yet? We need to put something on the birth certificate.
Yes, I have. His name is Raymond.
Outside the courthouse, Super, May 11th, 1956. We see an angled view of the courthouse. It is an old, imposing building, gleaming white in the sun. People are walking around quickly, going in and out of the building. On the street is a crowd of black people, finely dressed. They hold protest signs like, "Desegregate our buses. Segregation has got to go. Stop abusing our people and let us sit." In the courthouse courtroom, it is the same courtroom Claudette had her original trial in. Inside the courtroom is dark wood walls, the giant windows taking up one wall. The room quickly fills. Whites fill up the first few rows, but behind them are dozens of blacks. In the balcony are at least 100 more spectators. The room becomes packed with so many people that it seems that there is room for no more. In the courthouse hallway, Claudette stands against one wall, her hand worrying at part of her dress. QP stands next to her, his hand on her shoulder.
"You could go, your mother wouldn't be here. She could. Her boss wouldn't let her have the day off. They want a house cleaned for a party or something."
"Yeah, no. I'll make her proud anyway."
Reverend H.H. Johnson walks up to them.
"Claudette, you okay?"
Claudette looks up at the Reverend.
"Yes, sir, I am."
"You know, if you don't feel up to this, you don't have to do it. It's not too late to back out."
"With all due respect, Reverend, it is too late. Too much rides on this. It doesn't matter if I feel up to it. If Harriet Tubman had the strength to free slaves, I can have the strength to help free my people in what little ways I can."
QP squeezes her shoulder. Fred Gray walks down the hallway towards them.
"Ready, Claudette?"
Claudette nods goodbye to Reverend Johnson and follows Fred through the courtroom doors. QP follows behind her. Reverend Johnson stares at their backs as they go. A smile grows on his face. In the courthouse courtroom, the room is packed. Fred and Claudette sit at the plaintiff's table with three other black women. Aurelia Browder, sturdy 37-year-old, Susie McDonald, frail 77-year-old, and Mary Louise Smith, a stubborn 19-year-old.
"All rise for the Honorable Justices Reeves, Lynn, and Johnson."
Reeves, Lynn, and Johnson file into the room and sit at the bench. Reeves bangs the gavel.
"Plaintiff, call your first witness."
"We call Aurelia Browder to the witness stand."
Aurelia stands from her seat and confidently strides across the room to the witness box.
"You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?"
"I do."
"Mrs. Browder, how often do you ride the bus?"
"I'm currently not riding the bus."
"Why not?"
"Because of the boycott, sir."
"Well then, when you were riding the bus before the boycott, how often did you ride?"
"Oh, a good 2 or 3 times a day."
"And is the bus boycott the only reason you stopped riding the bus?"
"Kinda, sir. I didn't stop just to join in, but because I believe in the cause."
"The cause?"
"I knew if I would cooperate with my color, I would get better treatment on the buses."
"So you felt your treatment on the bus was bad?"
"Yes, I did. I was frequently forced to give up my seat for white people and have to stand where they sat."
"If you were permitted to sit any place you wanted on the bus, would you be willing to ride it again?"
"Yes, I would, sir."
"No further questions."
A tall, rail-thin older man, Walter Knabe, stands from the defendant's table.
"Now, isn't it true that the boycott was all Martin King's idea?"
I don't know whose idea it was, sir. All I know is that it was a good one.
But he is the one telling you people to not ride the bus.
Ain't nobody telling me anything. I made the decision to join the boycott myself.
You're claiming King didn't tell you to boycott?
I've never even met Dr. King before, sir. He would never have had the opportunity to tell me anything.
Susie is now on the stand.
And what do you do for a living?
I'm a widow. My son pays me to do housekeeping for him.
And you have to ride the bus to get to your son's home?
I used to. Now I get a ride with my neighbor. I don't want to ride the bus until things change.
Change how, Mrs. McDonald?
When I rode the bus, I was often mistreated. I'm not as young as I used to be, but I would often be forced to give up my seat to people young enough to be my grandbabies. My bones can't handle all that standing anymore.
If you didn't have to give up your seat anymore, would you start riding the bus again?
I sure would.
Admit it, King influenced you to stop riding the bus.
I don't need someone to influence me to do anything. I made it 77 years on my own judgment. I stopped because I thought it was the right thing to do, and we were being mistreated.
You are 77 then? Did you not have a problem with the bus system before the boycott?
Yes, I did. I just didn't have the collection of the community behind me before.
Knob lets out a huff of frustration. Next is Mary Louise in the witness box.
What happened to lead up to your arrest?
I was riding on the bus back in October and the bus got full. The driver told me to get up and I said no, that I'm not going to move out of my seat. I got the same privilege to sit here as anybody else.
And what happened after that?
The driver called the police and I was arrested. I was charged with not obeying segregation laws and my dad paid my fine.
Are you willing to ever ride the bus again?
I would ride the city buses again, provided we had no segregation on them.
King put you up to this, didn't he?
Put me up to what?
The boycott. Not riding the bus.
Nobody put me up to anything, sir.
Doesn't King represent y'all?
He doesn't represent anybody. We represent ourselves. He was appointed our leader.
No more questions, Your Honor.
In that case, let us break for a recess. Everyone be back in court at 2 o'clock sharp.
In the courthouse side room, Susie, Mary Louise, Aurelia, and Claudette sat at a table, picking at sandwiches. They are all visibly tired, shoulders drooped, lethargic movements. Fred walks into the room.
I just want to tell you that you're all doing a wonderful job. Mrs. McDonald, Miss Browder, Miss Smith, your testimonies were all perfect.
Fred moves to sit at the table as he speaks.
They are trying to prove that Dr. King is the one agitating things, but you are all proving that you made your own decisions.
That's because we did. We ain't doing nothing but telling the truth up there.
And the truth is exactly what we need. Even if things don't go our way, we have enough foundation for an appeal already.
Does that mean you don't need me?
Oh, no, Claudette. I was specially saving you for last. You're our youngest member and have the strongest story to tell. We always save our secret weapon for last.
In the courthouse, back in the courtroom, everyone is back in their seats. The judges are back on the bench.
We would like to call its final witness, Claudette Colvin, to the stand.
Claudette stands and nervously smooths down her dress. She walks over to the stand, head held high.
I can do this. Harriet Tubman is with me.
She gets up to the stand and carefully sits. Every eye in the courtroom is on her. The bailiff walks over with a Bible. Claudette places her hand on it at his instruction.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
There is a moment of silence throughout the room as Fred looks over his questions. Claudette looks out at the room spread before her. She doesn't recognize them, but Nixon and Joanne are there. Also in the crowd are Ms. Nesbitt, Rosa Parks, and MLK. She looks at the other woman involved in the case. Her eyes then scan the crowd and see QP. He smiles at her, and she straightens her back and smiles back.
Ms. Colvin, can you tell the court how old you are?
I'm 16, Mr. Gray.
And how old were you on March 2nd, 1955?
I was 15.
Can you tell us, in your own words, what happened to you that day?
Yes, sir. We got out of school early on account of there being a teacher meeting. Me and my friends were heading home on the bus. At the Court Square stop, this white lady boarded the bus. There were already a lot of people already riding, so she came to my row. My friends got up to give her their seats, but she is just one lady and doesn't need all four of our seats, and I paid my money just like her. The driver tried to make me get up, but I wouldn't. It's my constitutional right to sit there just like her. It ain't fair to make us all get up just so she won't have to sit next to no Negro. So when I wouldn't get up, the driver got the police on me and they arrested me.
Can you tell us what those charges were?
Disturbing the peace, breaking segregation laws, and assault.
And can you tell us what happened during your arrest?
They claimed I was kicking and screaming and scratching at them, but I wasn't. I didn't do anything to anybody. I just let my body go limp and kept repeating that being there was my constitutional right. I was scared and them grabbing me hurt. I was crying. In the police car, they kept calling me a...
Claudette looks nervously at Fred.
I don't want to swear, but they kept calling me that one that starts with a B. They was all so talking about my breasts.
Thank you, Miss Colvin. I know it must be hard for you to relive that traumatic day.
I guess if they thought I was adult enough to be taken to the adult jail, I am adult enough to tell my story.
The courtroom is silent except for one woman crying in the back. It is unclear who the woman is.
Thank you, Claudette. I have no further questions.
Knob jumps up from his seat and is walking towards Claudette before Fred gets back to his seat.
You and the other Negroes have changed your ideas since the 5th of December when this boycott started, haven't you?
No, sir. We haven't changed our ideas. These ideas have been in me since the day I was born.
When you all stopped riding the buses hoping for certain things, right? Things King told you all to object to?
No, sir. They started to see how dirty Negroes, and especially us Negro girls, are treated after I got arrested. Some people just ain't have the guts to stand up yet.
Did y'all have a leader?
We are our own leaders.
Somebody had to speak up for y'all, though.
We spoke up for ourselves, sir.
Did you not select somebody to represent you?
Well, we wasn't going to have some ignorant person representing us. It had to be someone strong enough to speak up and knows the laws. It's natural that we aren't going to get up here ourselves when not all of us can even read or write. But everyone knew who it was that was treating us wrong.
So you picked King?
No, we didn't.
But you just said that you elected someone who knew better than y'all.
We ain't elect anybody. We all just met together and discussed things. Together.
I am trying to understand you, Miss Colvin. Was King the one who represented all y'all Negroes to the city commission to tell them what y'all wanted?
I don't know.
What about Mr. Gray? Was he the one y'all felt knew the law better?
Yeah, he is a lawyer.
Why did you stop riding the bus on December 5th?
I stopped riding before that. I stopped because I knew how we were being treated as less than white folks was wrong.
Fred Gray paces back and forth in front of the judges.
Your Honors, we brought this case in front of you today because a great injustice is being perpetrated in Montgomery every day. Too many of this great city's citizens are treated as if they don't matter. Children are being beaten and abused by police, the ones that are supposed to protect them. The elderly are forced to stand on their feet after a long day's work, so younger people are allowed to sit in comfort. This isn't purely an issue of black and white. It's an issue of respect. Respect to all the citizens of Montgomery. Today, Montgomery has been given the chance to change, to show it loves its people, to be the first to stand up for what is right. But also, it is a chance to show the country that Montgomery respects the Constitution. Just a few years ago, judges much like you ruled that segregation within schools was unconstitutional. Brown versus Board of Education argues that segregation is not equal in schools. It is based on the same premise of this case. Separate is not equal on our buses, and Browder versus Gale could forever be known as the case that proved that.
Outside Sherry's Diner that night, Claudette is in a waitress uniform. She balances a tray with several plates and cups teetering on it. Claudette walks up to a table with three young people sitting.
Your burger and chocolate milkshake, your salad, dressing on the side, and the daily special and Coke.
Claudette places each meal in front of the correct person.
Can I get you anything else?
They dismiss her, and Claudette walks back to the diner counter. The group huddle together and whisper.
Is that?
I think so.
No way. It isn't.
Yeah, it is.
Nuh-uh.
I'm gonna go ask.
The girl gets up from her seat and walks over to where Claudette stands marrying ketchup bottles.
Excuse me?
Claudette looks up.
Yes, did you need something else?
No, I just had to know. Are you that girl? The one from the trial?
Claudette sighs and looks down.
Yeah, I'm her.
The girl lets out a loud squee.
I knew it. I knew it. And they didn't believe me. I seen you the day of the trial when you left for the day. I knew I recognized you.
Claudette forces a tight smile.
It's me. But now I really need to get back to work.
My friends are never going to believe me when I tell them all I met the It's My Constitutional Rights girl working at Cherry's Diner.
The girl turns and walks away. She yells to her friends.
Say, I told you it was her.
Patrons all across the room stare at Claudette. Claudette tries to ignore it, looking nowhere but at the ketchup bottle she goes back to marrying, when a voice booms behind her.
Claudette, I need to see you in the back.
Claudette's shoulders sink.
Yes, Mrs. Sherry.
In the back room, the room is cluttered. Filing cabinets overflow with papers on every wall. A small wood desk sits topped with more stacks of papers and ledgers. There is a desk chair behind it that Cherry sits in. In front of the desk sits a rickety folding chair that looks like the weight of a feather would break it. Claudette gingerly sits in the chair.
Now, when I hired you, I didn't know who you were. You lied and said your last name was Austin.
I didn't lie. That's the name on my birth certificate.
Be that as it may, I can't have you working here. It's a disturbance, and I don't need no trouble.
I don't need no trouble either, Mrs. Sherry. I promise you.
Ain't no promises from you gonna assure me that the Klan ain't gonna come in here and burn my business just because some girl wants to change the way things work.
But Mrs.
No buts. I need you to leave and you can come back tomorrow and pick up your pay and drop off your uniform.
In the Colvin home front room, Mary sits on the couch with a newspaper in her hand. The door opens and Claudette walks in. Her feet are dragging the apron that she was previously wearing is clutched in her hand. Mary looks up, then at her watch.
You home early? Slow night?
Mrs. Sherry fired me.
Fired again? That's the third job this month. What happened?
The usual. Someone recognized me and it was decided I would cause too much disturbance.
Claudette flops down on the couch next to her mother and lays her head on Mary's shoulder.
I'm the hardest worker in that diner, and this is how I get repaid.
Mary pets her daughter's hair.
It's not your fault. These people are all just cowards, too scared to stand up for what is right.
I need a job, though, Mama. I can't take care of Raymond if I can't make any money.
A wail of a baby's cry sounds through the house.
Speaking of him.
Claudette slowly pushes herself off the couch and makes her way to the back of the house. In the bedroom, Raymond lays in a bassinet crying. He is now bigger and a little darker, and his hair has turned black. He is still very light-skinned, though. Claudette goes over to him and picks him up. She rocks him until he quiets down.
There, there, sweetie. Mama's here now. No need to cry.
Tears start to stream down Claudette's face.
No need to cry at all. We're gonna make it out one way or another. Together we will fight through whatever comes our way.
In the courthouse, judges' chambers, Rives, Lynn, and Johnson sit at a table conferring. There are legal briefs and thick legal texts scattered across the table.
We cannot ignore the precedent of Plessy versus Ferguson.
While I agree we can't ignore the case, it stands to show that when it comes to public transportation, separate is not equal.
How so? The Negroes have the same seats. They do not. That is by definition equality.
If it was equal, then Negroes wouldn't need to get off the bus to enter from the rear after paying when white people are sitting. They also would not be forced to give up their seats, which is what this entire case hinges on.
Johnson is correct. As much as I would like to keep things as it is, Gray makes a compelling point. In the case of buses in Montgomery, things have not been equal.
So we could just rule to stop having to make them get up.
I think that that is too little too late at this point. Many bus drivers are still going to try and enforce the rule, whether it's still on the books or not. We have to go all the way and desegregate if things are ever going to improve.
I think it is obvious which way I vote. I'm in favor of the city. Keep things the way they are if they must change. Make it a rule that drivers cannot force people out of their seat. The Supreme Court already spoke on this issue in Plessy versus Ferguson. It is the law, and it is not our place to change that law.
And I vote in favor of Gray. His point on Brown versus Board of Education was correct. As far as I'm concerned, state-imposed segregation of public facilities violates the Constitution. It's a simple case of legal and human rights being denied.
So you have the deciding vote, Reeves.
In the courthouse courtroom, the room is full but noticeably less packed than it was the day of the trial. Super reads, June 19th, 1956. Rives, Lynn, and Johnson sit in their seats. Claudette and the other plaintiffs are back at the table they sat at before. The air is thick with anticipation. No one talks above a whisper. The sound of a gavel hitting wood echoes across the room. A hush falls.
In the case of Browder versus Gale, we the judges rule in favor of the plaintiffs.
Shouts raise up from the crowd, most in jubilation, some in anger. The gavel slams are heard across the room.
Order in the court! Order in the court!
The courtroom settles down.
We cannot, in good conscience, perform our duty as judges by blindly following the precedent of Plessy versus Ferguson, when our study leaves us in complete agreement that the separate but equal doctrine can no longer be safely followed as a correct statement of law. In fact, we think that Plessy versus Ferguson has been impliedly, although not explicitly, overruled, and that, under later decisions, there is now no rational basis upon which the separate but equal doctrine can be validly applied to public transportation in Montgomery and its police jurisdictions.
Whispers start back up throughout the courtroom. Rives speaks louder to be clearly heard.
We hold that the statutes and ordinances requiring segregation of the white and colored races on the buses in Montgomery violate the true process and equal protection of the law clauses of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States.
Rives bangs his gavel again.
Court dismissed.
The three judges stand to file out. In the hallway, Gray leaves the courtroom and starts heading towards the exit of the building. Gale bursts out of the courtroom and walks fast over to Gray. Gale is purple in the face with anger. He grabs Gray by the arm and spins the man around to face him.
You may have won this round, but you better believe this isn't over. Montgomery will never integrate its buses or anything else. Mark my words, I'll be appealing this even if it means taking it all the way to the Supreme Court. So you and the other Negroes better not get too excited about this.
Gray calmly stares as Gale rants. When Gale is done, Gray gives a polite nod and pulls his arm out of Gale's grasp.
You do that, sir. Me and the others at the NAACP will be there every step of the way to fight you. Even if it goes all the way to Supreme Court. We won't stop walking and boycotting until segregation on our buses are a thing of the past, Mr. Mayor.
In the Colvin home front room, Claudette sits with a much bigger Raymond on her lap. She is feeding him and bobbing her head along as the radio plays something like Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers, Why Do Fools Fall in Love? Super reads November 13th, 1956. When the song ends, the radio announcer speaks.
Breaking news. The Supreme Court has announced this ruling in the latest appeal for the now infamous Browder versus Gale case. It's now official from the highest court in the county in the country that buses in Alabama are to be desegregated.
Claudette looks up in mild interest at the news. Raymond finishes drinking from his bottle and starts to cry. Claudette turns her attention back to him as another song starts to play.
Oh, who's a Mr. Fussy Face? Come on, don't cry.
Claudette stands up and starts walking around the room, rocking Raymond into pacification.
Didn't you just hear that buses are desegregated? Mommy helped do that. Mommy did that so that you never have to sit at the back of the bus or give up your seat to no white person. I did that for you, baby, for our future.
Fade to black. The song Claudette Colvin Goes to Work begins to play. The following text cards fade onto the screen accompanied by real photos. First card, a picture of Edie Nixon and other NAACP members appear. After the trial, most members of the NAACP did not contact Claudette ever again. Second card, a photo from the first desegregated bus ride appears. While Reverend Ralph Abernathy, a reporter, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and Reverend Glenn Smiley were among the first to ride the newly integrated buses, Claudette was not invited. Third card. Claudette eventually had to move to New York to find work and spend over 30 years working as a nurse's assistant before retiring. Fourth card. A photo of Rosa Parks on the bus appears. As Rosa Parks' fame grew, Claudette fell more into obscurity. Too afraid of losing jobs, she never talked about her part in the boycott and the resulting legal case. Fifth card, a photo of young Claudette morphs into present-day Claudette. Claudette still resides in the Bronx. The end.
There's our air horn. He's back. Yay! Nice. Well, thank you very much, Tracy and Canada, for sharing your script with us. It was great to read. So we're now going to give the feedback. It's unfortunate we have so few people, because it's one of the great parts of doing this is getting so many different people's opinions. But we will post the script in our Discord group as well. So if you're listening later and you want to give the script a read, you can send feedback to Tracy. I'm sure she'll super appreciate it. I made just a few notes as I was multitasking, hosting, and doing several roles. One is someone told me a while ago not to put the mores or continueds at the top and bottom of pages. It actually takes up a lot of page space, and I just find it annoying to see. So I will give you the same advice, which I think is just remove the continueds, which is something you can uncheck in Final Draft if that's what you use, which of course is going to lose you some pages. And you're already short on pages being at 80, but you have a lot of action paragraphs that I think you can break up into multiple paragraphs where you've got like several things going on, several different types of actions in one paragraph that you could break up and just put more spacing between it. So you might be able to get this up to 90 pages just by doing that. I thought the dialogue was really great, and it was a really great insight into history that a lot of people don't know about. I think it has really great potential. I wish you the best of luck with it. The final thing I will say is definitely give it a proofread. I think it's worthy of having a proofread. You've got more than a couple typos in there. Usually they're more like typos where it's like words have been dropped, or like two words are separate, like yourself is two words, and so that might not come up in a spell check, or you know, the theirs are wrong or the yours are wrong. So if you can give it a proper proofread, I recommend that, obviously. And I'm gonna go now to Kat, first person on the list, who always loves being first to give feedback. What were your thoughts on the script?
I really, really enjoyed it. I've always really liked sort of true life hero stories, and this was no exception. It was very interesting. I felt that you kept the, I mean, obviously it's kind of, some of it is based on history and some of it is just sort of dramatized, but I think it flowed really nicely. It was educational, but also really enjoyable. The moments where Claudette was like sitting on the bus, refusing to get up, I was like cheering along with her. And then when Rosa did the same thing, I was like, it like felt like watching history unfold. I think you did a really good job of portraying that on the page, I guess. I made a couple of notes on typos that I noticed while I was reading through it, which is probably not a comprehensive list, but I will send it to you anyway via PM, because it's easier to go back and look at it than if I'm just chatting. Plus listing a bunch of page numbers and some typos is not going to be fun for anyone to hear. But I wish I'd seen this film when I was a kid, because I would have really, really loved it. And I hope you get it made, because I would really love to watch it now. Yeah, no, that's it, really. It was very good. I enjoyed it very much. As Smish said, one or two typos, which I'm going to send you a list of the ones I noticed. I didn't make any comprehensive notes because I didn't really have a lot of time to do it. but no, I really, really enjoyed it. So thank you so much for submitting. Great job. And try and get it made, because it's really good and it's a story that should be heard.
Nice. Thanks, Kat. Moving on now to Erica, who did a great job in the lead role. Thank you very much, our resident Black person. Sorry. Okay, what were your thoughts on the script?
Hi, yeah. Okay, so I really liked it. I didn't know about this story. Just because I'm Black doesn't mean I know all of Black history, right? So this was interesting to read this true story, so I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed, you know, her tenacity, and her being Claudette, the main character that I read, and her fight, and all of her lines and everything like that. I really, really enjoyed it. And the only thing that I found a bit confusing, and I don't know if this was creative license, if you did this on purpose, or if you didn't notice that you did it, for Martin Luther King Jr.'s character himself, in the beginning you called him MLK, and I'm assuming this was the same character, but then when he gives the, I think it's a speech, you start referring to him as King, and then you go back to MLK. And so anyone else reading that would assume it was two separate people, but I'm assuming it's the same person. So I think just for continuity's sake, and for not confusing the reader, if MLK is supposed to be the Martin Luther King Jr. that you're referring to in the middle of the script, sticking to naming, or you know, giving the person's lines the same name, I think is supposed to be one of the things that you do when you're writing a script. So that confused me a little. And also I think it's the lawyer who's referred to as, I think it's Gray when it's the lines, but then when you do the prose, you put his first name as Fred, which confused me, because I think you didn't do that until you got like to the middle towards the end. So for a second, I was a bit jarred and I was saying, wait, who's Fred again? Because I was like, wait, I thought the guy's name was Gray, because that's what we've been calling him. And then you start referring to Gray as Gary when you're doing the prose outside of the actual dialogue. I won't say anything about the typos because everyone else said stuff about the typos. And then the last note that I made for myself, and this might actually add a little bit of pages, is I was shocked that nothing else was ever mentioned about Ray. Beyond the fact that she was refused to mention who he was, the fact that when we meet him and the two or three scenes that he's in, it's obvious that he is infatuated with her. I found it really hard to believe that she gets pregnant and we're supposed to believe that he basically dropped off the face of the planet, that he never went to find out that she was pregnant, that she never told him, that there wasn't some sort of scene that happened where at least he said, I'm not going to have anything to do with that. You know, I just, to go from a man who appeared, I guess, to be charming and infatuated towards her, at least to the point of, you know, bedding her, and then to like kind of have him gone from the script entirely, I would have liked a bit more context on what happened, that he really did just disappear. And I think that if you give at least one or two scenes to go into that, to explain that a little bit more, it would be nice, especially because, you know, the baby is kind of the catalyst for Claudette to continue to do what she's doing. So it would have been nice to have a bit of a tie up on what happened between her and this man who she had a one night stand with, basically. But otherwise, I liked the story. That's basically just like, I guess, a B or C story. So maybe that's why it was left out. But, you know, for me personally, I think it would help the story a bit if I get a bit more on him. But otherwise, I really enjoyed the script. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Erica. Moving on now to Paul. What were your thoughts on the script?
Hello. Well, first of all, thank you so much. Thank you very much, Tracy, because that was brilliant. It was so good. It's worth mentioning that we've been through like the opening section of it, like the first 10 pages or so, a few times in like the Tuesday table read. And I was kind of, when I saw that it was this script, I was kind of thinking, well, am I just going to be bored by the first 10 minutes of it? Because, you know, we've workshopped it a few times, and then didn't at all. And I was just enthralled by the whole thing. Unfortunately, I didn't make very many notes because I was using my finger all the time to hold down the button because, you know, that's what happens when you get 22 rolls. However, it was really good. Yeah, I agree with everything that everyone has said before. Just a quick thing on Ray. I agree that it would also increase like your page count slightly if you've got something more about Ray, because at the moment he's just this nice guy who's suddenly not there, and I feel like we kind of need to, you know, see more of that. One thing in terms of the characters, similar issue that Kat and Erica have mentioned. You've got Preacher Johnson, but you also, one of the judges is called Johnson. And so when I was given my my character list, I thought it was the same guy until we got halfway through and I realized. So I just have a look at all the when you're doing the proofreading and going through and sorting out all the typos and all that kind of stuff, have a look at the character names as well, because stuff like that is confusing. There are like three Marys and there's two Johnsons, and it did get confusing at times. Luckily, they're in very different parts of the script, so I managed to work it out. Structurally, I thought it was spot on. Really, I didn't feel like there was any part of it that really dragged. I was just engrossed the whole way through. I watched a movie the other day. It was nominated for the Oscar. It was Hidden Figures, which it reminded me of, because obviously that's a biopic. And I felt like obviously the parallel, I was drawing parallels in my head about that. And I thought this dealt with everything really well. I felt like I don't know much about the whole thing. Obviously, I don't know much about American culture in general because I'm not an American. But I felt like I got like a really good feel for everything that was happening in there and a real good sense of the history. So yeah, it was great. Thank you so much. And I really enjoyed it. Tidy up, sort it out, and make it into a movie. Thank you.
Nice. Thanks, Paul. And moving on finally to Cheddar. What were your thoughts on the script?
Well, first of all, thank you, Tracy and Canada, for submitting your script. I didn't really take down any notes because I was busy narrating and had a few roles myself. I thought it was really good, though. You know, obviously, I had a difficult time reading some of the prose, but that's already been addressed. The typos, and not just typos, but kind of the flow of it sometimes too could use some tweaking. But yeah, other than that, I don't have much to say other than that I thought it was really good and a really interesting story that I never knew about. So yeah, good on you. I hope that more people get to hear this story.
Awesome. Yeah, I think it has a lot of potential. I can definitely see this one getting like optioned and hopefully made if she can get it into the right person's hands. So good luck to you, Tracy. Thank you so much for sharing it with us. Thank you, everybody, for watching. That's going to be it for today. We'll be back next week at 4 p.m. Pacific with another script or several scripts, maybe. We will see. If you're a table reader, you can now sign up to read for next week. And that's it. Say goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye,
everybody.